Welcome to Mainland, your local regional television station. I'm Graham O'Brien, and some of the stories coming up in today's news. Standing room only at Mapua, a house for Christmas, flag flogging, and more. Mapua residents and boat club members packed into the Mapua Hall on Monday night to hear representatives from their council present their side of the boat ramp issue. Mapua and Districts Community Association Chairwoman Elena Meredith hosted the standing room only public forum on the issue an hour before the association's regular meeting. Ward councillors Trevor Norris and Brian Ensor spoke at the meeting, along with TDC Commercial Manager Jean Cooper and TDC's Transportation Manager Gary Clark, before Mapua Boat Club member Martin Barlow spoke to an enthusiastic audience. Mainland was there at the meeting.
We have council staff, we're here to listen, so please take that on board.
So I've been the chair of the Mapua Wharf Advisory Group for the 2 years since its inception, and there was a request from the Mapua Community Association to the mayor to set up a group to represent the different views of various organisations within the community and work with staff in the management of the wharf area and what we call the waterfront park. And we include the Mapua Association, have representatives on that, the Mapua Business Association. We have representatives from the boat club. We've achieved a lot down there, a lot of development, and I know some of you boat club members aren't happy about development, you're not happy about growth. But, you know, we're in a changing world. So that's just an overview. We are supportive of a new ramp or improvements to a new ramp.
So just to recap, health and safety report telling us we had to effectively close the wharf for traffic and manage that risk. The point of today is actually to get the issues out there as they actually stand. So first of all, it's not closed, it will be restricted. Those are the restrictions based on the activities that we have now. I think the next thing is there's the discussion about existing use rights that belong to the boat club. You know, I think there was existing use rights when it was swapped over in 87, 88, 89 from the Harbour Board, effectively. But that expired in 2001, and they haven't been in place for the last two leases that you've got in place. I think also watching the Mainland TV and position that was there, it was good to see a boat club member actually say it is a risky place, it is dangerous. But apart from that issue, I think there was mention that the council have made an offer to the boat club to move premises. Not correct. As it stands at today, there's no offer on any table, there hasn't been any discussion. And I think the fourth issue for me is that I think there's been this discussion point, there just hasn't been any communication or consultation with the community, and that is just not correct. So through that advisory board, this issue's been on the table for 9 to 10 months. And so if you're sitting there and said, you know, I haven't heard enough, it's because for all intents and purposes, you need to have a discussion inside the boat club as to why that information is not being levelled back into the boat club.
So the job I've been tasked is to look at the options and do a risk-based and benefit approach to what is the best option, because with any option that's out there, there are pros and cons for either of them, and you're probably very aware of those in the community about, you know, Waterfront Park or Grossy Point or Leisure Park Land or Rough Island or Motueka. There's an existing boat ramp. So there's a whole bunch of options to look at, and my job's been tasked to look at those.
Okay, so the boat club weren't able to arrange a meeting with our three ward councillors to discuss a solution to the boat ramp access. So we accepted this opportunity for members and the Sea Scouts, who have been completely overlooked with the restricted access we now have as a result of the commercialisation at the Mapua Wharf precinct. First, a bit of history, just to remind us why we still have a wharf, boat ramp and boating activity here in Mapua. Boating activity, which I think you'd have to agree, helped give Mapua some of its uniqueness and aesthetic values that make us want to live here and keep Mapua as our home. In 87, the Harbour Board was going to dismantle the wharf. Neither the Harbour Board or the TDC had any interest in it, and so the Mapua Boat Club stepped forward and offered to maintain the wharf and was granted a lease along with approval to build a boat ramp alongside the wharf. Contrary to comments from some quarters, the boat club did not have sole or exclusive access to the boat ramp. Anyone could and did use it. You might remember the estuary jet boat tours that used to operate from there. Kayakers use it. Of course, the Sea Scouts use it. And cyclists in the ferry have used it. Over the last 10 or 12 years, access has slowly been restricted through the removal of the dinghy rack on the wharf, removal of trailer parking at the boat ramp, and a lack of manoeuvrability as commercial activity expanded. The conflict's been created by the TDC, endorsed by our councillors, not acting upon the concerns of the boat club and the boating community, who have preferred to allow the slow and continuous creep of commercial interests at the wharf. This slow creep has now reached a full crescendo with a $1.4 million TDC investment in Shed 4 and has now resulted in access restrictions to all vehicles. Dean Cooper's also stated to the Barpool Boat Club that, and I quote, boat clubs throughout the country do not have access directly to the wharf. They move gear through marinas to get to their boat, and in this instance it's no different. I think we're putting up obstacles for the sake of it sometimes. And let me say right here, we're not putting up obstacles for the sake of it, as this development has now proven. The fact is this slow creep and conflict has seen pressure shift to Grossy Point, where up to 40 plus trailer rigs can be on any given morning or evening at this time of the year when the snapper are in the bay. The Grossy Point presser has now resulted in conflict between picnickers, swimmers, walkers and neighbours, all to satisfy the commercial growth at the expense of our community. The question to Mr Cooper, when will health and safety trump this? For now, Council seem okay with this conflict and forget about health and safety and the damage to the reserve at Grossy's Point, as they have allocated $80,000 to develop Grossy Point. Yet on the TDC website boat ramp list, it refers to Grossy Point as subject to significant tidal effects and may be usable only on a high tide with local knowledge. The best time to go swimming at Grossy Point? Yep, high tide.
So Martin, if you got the idea that we refuse to meet with you, that is incorrect.
You didn't and actually I, say that. And you I, said he was unable to make
yeah, it. Okay, righto. The other thing about money into the wharf that the boat club's maintained it wholly and solely for 28 years is also incorrect. My engineering budget and the upgrade of the wharf was $700,000 of ratepayers' money that came from district wide. So the council has put money into the maintenance of that wharf. I just wanted to put that correct. Yeah. But at the end of the day, as a ward councillor, I was involved in the discussions with the way back in Marion's here somewhere, with the Sea Scouts and access. And the other thing, Gene, you didn't point out, that when Martin came to council and raised the issue of the boats that are moored and access to them, we have spoken with them. It was something that was in the background, and I think, Martin, there's a dinghy rack or something going to be put there available.
Can I just comment on that, Trevor? That actually highlights the whole issue. You know, when I raised that point with them about access to moored boats and where we, how do we get our dinghies in there, they told me, Ryan Ensor and Trevor Norris told me, we'd never thought of that. And that just highlights the fact
that's not correct. Haven't
been listened to.
That is not correct, Martin.
This is a two-minute slot, Trevor, and it's not going to be a
stain. Well, we're fair game, but I just want to issue, say we are here to try and come to something that suits everyone.
I really want to acknowledge that this issue is far bigger than an hour's discussion can deal with. All we've done is pull it open and have a look. In terms of the Community Association, I will undertake to make sure that in the next few minutes that is on our agenda, and we discuss how we will do that. We've got connections with Martin. We can join in with Jeff and, I presume, the Sea Scouts. And if there are other people that would like to be part of that particular working group, then obviously something like this, the more people we can have that are actually putting a focus on it, the better.
Some lucky Nelson families have moved into their brand new affordable rental housing in time for Christmas, thanks to the Nelson Tasman Housing Trust. The trust was designed to offer low-cost housing to those in need. I went and spoke to the director, Keith Parson, of the trust to find out more. Keith, you've got quite a nice little housing area going on down here. Can you tell us a bit more about this area and what you've got going on for the Nelson Tasman Housing Trust?
Yeah, sure, Graham. This is our latest scheme. It was opened on last Friday, in fact, by Nick Smith and Rachel Rees. We had a good turnout. We had a dawn blessing by Harvey Ruru, and then we're back at 10 o'clock for the main opening. It's four new houses in two blocks. There's two four-bedroom houses at this end, and down the far end there's two three-bedroom houses. They've all got our normal energy-efficient features, such as solar hot water heating, and we've got heat pumps in them, extra insulation, and the idea is to try and keep the cost in use down for the tenants. They're all rental properties, so we're charging an affordable rent for these houses. This is the second phase of a scheme up here. We've got eight houses which we opened a couple of years ago, just down the road here, and these this bring the total up to 12. It's quite a nice scheme in that there's lots of space, you get fantastic views. It was quite a challenging scheme to develop because the slope is so steep. We had lots of engineering issues. So this scheme here actually took about 2-3 years from start to finish, compared to a scheme we opened up earlier this year, which took about less than a year just to get going because it was flat, and it just makes a huge difference. But it's been worth it. You're always thinking when you're going through the pain of new schemes, you know, is it really worth it? But once it's all finished and the tenants have moved in, it's fantastic. We have good space standards. We provide sort of a good kitchen. The tenants bring their own furniture, basically, once the tenants are here, they're here for a long time. If they pay the rent and keep the place nice, we look after the place, then we're happy for them to stay. Yep.
Yes, sounds great, Keith. And how do you choose the people to go in? Is it just a lucky dip? Everyone puts their name in the hat?
No, we get referrals from local agencies like the Women's Centre and Salvation Army, Victory Community Centre. We also take people from the Social Housing Register, and that is run by basically Work and Income, MSD, Ministry of Social Development. So if you need housing, people apply to there, and if they qualify, then they'll refer the people onto us for our housing. And we try and get a mixture, a balance of people, so we don't want high concentrations of old people or high concentrations of young families. We try and get a community going. We think that it's important to try and get the dynamics of the community right.
Sure, good scheme. And you're talking about being on the hill, but of course the good side of being on the hill is the great views you get up here.
Yeah, fantastic views. You get views right over town in one direction, right up to Bishopdale and up into the hills in the other direction. These houses here in particular are nice and warm. You get good sun throughout most of the year. And the first scheme, some of the houses don't get that much sun in the winter, but generally speaking, I'd say at least half of the houses in the scheme would get fantastic sun for most of the year. Yeah.
Nice. And you say you've got 12 houses up here now. How many houses in total have you got?
We've got 39 houses, most of them in Nelson. We've got 10, in fact, in Richmond, but the rest of them are all in Nelson. And we're looking to build another scheme next year, all being well, if we get the funding sorted out in Stoke, and that will have 6 houses in it. So we're growing slowly. Yeah. I mean, we've been around for 10 years, and it takes a long time, but we're moving quite quickly, and we've got plans to sort of grow and hopefully move further afield as well, help other communities in other parts of the top of the south.
Flying in the face of the government's attempts to lower the cost of new home builds through changes to the RMA, Tasman District Council have announced this week that they will be hiking building fees, but at less cost than other neighbouring councils. Tasman District Council will increase their fees it charges for building consents from the 5th of January to meet rising costs associated with processing and checking consents. The increase will vary depending on the type of consent being sought, but one example is that a building consent for a new single-storey residential dwelling with a floor area between 121 square metres and 250 square metres will rise from $3,050 to $3,294. TDC's Environment and Planning Manager Dennis Bush-King said that the reality at the moment is that council are not charging enough to cover costs, leaving the general ratepayer subsidising those builds. He has said that even with the increase, their fees are still lower than those charged by other councils. Fees for a single-storey dwelling will be $3,294 in Tasman, $3,900 in Nelson, and $4,070 in Marlborough. A full list of the new fees will be available on the TDC website in December. Looking for some holiday reading or a Christmas present? Founders Summer Reads Book Fair at Founders Windmill began this week, so we decided to go and check it out. Murray, you've got a mini book fair going on down here. Can you tell us a little bit of the idea behind that, please?
Well, we've got an extensive stock of books that we've got together for our Queen's birthday sale, and we thought we'd have a mini one this summer. Because years ago, we used to take van loads out to the Dahuna camp and sell them over Christmas, so we thought we should have another go at capturing the Christmas market and the summer market with all the extra visitors in town. And so we've put some of our stock out. It's not the extensive stock that you'll find in our Queen's birthday big event, but it's a way to get rid of some of our extensive quality paperbacks that we've got. And you know, people are looking for summer reading. It's lying on the beach reading a book time of the year.
Sure is. And maybe some for the Christmas stockings as well.
Yes, they're pretty high quality and in good condition, so they wouldn't go astray in a Christmas stocking.
And Murray, you're saying that already you're basically overflowing with books, that you're passing them on already.
Yes, we're certainly going to have a bumper sale when Queen's birthday comes round, as we've got massive stocks. So we'll just sort of thin it out ever so slightly with this summer sale.
Great, and how many people have you got roughly helping you out, trying to sort all these books? I hear you've got a huge variety there.
Yeah, well, we have a basic core of about 10 sorters. We're sort of getting a little bit behind at the moment. There was 10 bins to sort today, with normally we cope with 4 bins in our sort of twice weekly sort that we do throughout the whole year.
Wow. And where are they coming in from? Just individuals dropping them off, or are you getting them in big groups from organisations?
Okay, they come from a variety of sources. I suppose that the steadiest supply is from the general public, who are downsizing, sorting through, or making more space in their shelves for the next lot of books that come in, plus some of the various op shops. They bring quite a few. We hope that they will pre-sort them rather than use our skips instead of their skip for the for all the Reader's Digest condensed books, etc.
The fair ends on Saturday the 30th of January 2016. The first part of the New Zealand flag referendum has produced a result, but is that the result that people are wanting? We asked some people on the street their thoughts raised on the issue of the New Zealand flag change.
I'd rather see the money spent on the flag spent on something like the poor kids, the orphans and the kids that really need it, rather than waste the time on a flag that we don't need, because the flag that we got now, our parents and grandparents fought for that flag, and I don't think we should get rid of it.
Got to get the red one, you know, the one that came second. And I think they should have had the other way around for a start. Whether they change the flag or not. So could have saved that money on the second one.
I don't think anything of it.
Great.
Because I sure won't be voting for any of them.
And how do you feel about the money that's been spent on it so far?
Scandalous.
Nice one-word answer.
No, I think it's just a child's game.
In all honesty, I'm not really too bothered. Yeah. I'm not even following it too much.
Any thoughts about the money that's been spent on it?
Oh, I think it could have been better spent just about anywhere else, to be quite fair. Yeah, because, I mean, didn't they have that poll or something to see who wanted it? Majority of people didn't want it. And it's like, if they go ahead with it anyway, like, what's the point in having votes if it's not going to be held to? So.
They should keep the old one. How's that go? Great.
After the break, we'll bring you the latest weather update and some events and happenings coming up from around the region.
Why would you want to pay as much as $1,000 for a single bed mattress when you can buy a high quality locally made mattress like this for as little as $220? And a queen size mattress could cost you in excess of $3,000, but at Nelson Beds you could have a mattress like this as low as $425. So why would you go out and spend a fortune on your child's bedroom when you can come to Nelson Beds and buy a complete single mattress and base set, a 7-drawer Scotch chest, a headboard and a 3-drawer bedside cabinet for as little as $979? So call and discuss our custom manufacturing options and local after sales service at Nelson Beds, Nelson's only bedding manufacturer.
Welcome to Smugglers Pub and Cafe, open 7 days a week with free parking all day. Our lunch menus have that old-fashioned flavour where we treat you like treasure with the food you'll savour.
We cater for children, grannies and granddads too, with special rates and privileges given to the elderly lunchtime crew. Our staff are friendly and kind and want to see you all come back time after time.
Daytime or evening, it doesn't matter. Give us a call on 546 4084 and we'll be happy to spoil you.
World War I was a defining period in our history, impacting greatly on the lives of people from the Nelson Province. Memories of the First World War is an exhibition which will be displayed in a number of regional venues and is currently on at the Nelson Provincial Museum.
Sit and Be Fit is on at the Victory Community Centre Tuesdays and Thursdays at 10 a.m. at the Victory Community Church, 238 Upper Vanguard Street. School terms only. Fun while you get fitter, work at your level.
Victory 60 Plus is on Tuesdays at 1:30 through to 3:30 p.m. at 238 Upper Vanguard Street. You can join in for cards, games and a cuppa.
On behalf of the team here at Mainland Television News, thank you for joining us and we'll bring you the latest news and events from around the region again tomorrow.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on air.
Are you looking for a scooter, walker, wheelchair, baby seats or pushchairs? Then come in and see the Nelson Region Specialists at Mobility for You, 269 Queen Street, Richmond, opposite the library. We have a huge selection of scooters, walkers, wheelchairs and accessories, along with a free booklet guide. We also provide a breakdown service if you ever get a puncture or a flat battery. We have fully equipped service vans to rescue you. Hi, I'm Robin Jordan and I invite you to call in and see the friendly team at Mobility for You, 269 Queen Street, Richmond, opposite the library.
Welcome me hearties to Smugglers Pub and Cafe, famous for hearty meals, craft ales and a friendly service way. Sensational seasonal menus with meals all day and evening too, or sail in for a snack with special menus for young smugglers and you. Settle in for a jolly old time, relax and enjoy our award-winning dining and lovely fine wine. Decked out in an old worldly way, we're open 7 days. Book or come on in to 8 Muirutai Street, not far from a beach, walk or swim. Phone 546408.
We're the team at JCAR, right here in Nelson, 120 Hardy Street. Our shop is full of electronic items,
including security alarm systems, electronic components,
solar and power,
electronics toys.
Sound systems, cables and much, much more.
Jacob. 120 Hardy Street, Nelson.
Nelson Tire Center, great prices, great service. Buy your own Bryford trailer, all types, all sizes. See Colin Douglas for your tires and batteries.
Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, well, you'd have to say it glows. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They wouldn't let poor Rudolph play in any reindeer games. Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say, Rudolph, with your nose so bright, won't you guide my sleigh tonight? Then how the reindeer loved him, and they shouted out with glee, Rudolph, the red-nosed reindeer, going down in history. Oh, Rudolph, what a shiner, brightens up the whole darn sky. Oh, Rudolph, looks like a miner prancing across the sky. Hoodie, murdery baby, ba 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 do 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 dee.
Say, I bet there's a couple in here you can wing, Frank.
Well, hear it here, and I'll give it a whirl. Say, that was very bright, old man. Now, here's one that most kids like. This kid does, too. Stand by.
You better watch out. You better not cry. Better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list, checking it twice. He's gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. You better not cry, better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Yes, he's on his way. He's got toys all over the sleigh. Santa, he is coming to town. Where'd you go? Oh, you're a pretty sneaky listener, you are. Say, you had Santa Claus really bouncing there, didn't you?
He was leaping.
You know, Frank, I was thinking with this fire and everything, we ought to take a swing at the Christmas song.
Christmas song?
Yeah, you know.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire.
Wonderful song.
Jack Frost nipping at your nose.
That's the kid.
Yuletide carols being sung by a choir. And folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows. A turkey and some mistletoe helps to make the season bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way.
Old Nick's coming, has it?
He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on the sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And so we're offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said
many times, many ways. Merry Christmas to you.